Yeah, thanks, Amy. Thanks for having me here. So the work that I'll present today, I guess it's been talked about at these kind of meetings at several occasions, but I've always enjoyed the discussions. I feel like there's different viewpoints to this similar topic. And if you've seen this presentation already, I forgive you if there's some repetition, but I've also found that sometimes we don't really understand the kind of system that we're working with, and sometimes the first time I present it gets lost, so please feel free to interrupt if there's something unclear. One of the things that I hope to get out of it is, you know, discussions about what would be interesting experiments for the future. So to set up the motivation, you've heard a lot of experimental, you've heard already quite some talks about looking at scrambling in experimental systems. Broadly speaking, in this work, the two questions that we want to answer is, can we experimentally probe scrambling in higher dimensional systems, where the particle information carriers are not necessarily two-level systems, or spin one halves, but higher dimensional? The motivation being that a lot of quantum field theories and also models for quantum gravity, as I understand, are naturally continuous variable or bosonic. So therefore, that's for us an interesting direction to go through. And secondly, there's been a lot of talk about how fast the system scrambles, characterizing the Lyapunov exponents. In this case, we have a system where we can very precisely measure individual carriers of information. And so we are interested in the question, precisely how and where does this quantum information flow, and then do a full characterization of this. So that's kind of to set it apart from other experimental works. So, in the group of Monica and also of Chris Monroe, we've seen already the work that's in the dimension 2 spin 1/2 particles, either atoms in a cavity or ions trapped. I usually try not to compare too much, but since there were so many questions already earlier, I just want to put it a little bit in perspective. I think it's really interesting, different regimes that that all these systems can work in. If I would have to put a label on it, I would say that the work in Monica, it's analog, it's large N, it's relatively fast, I think, so repetition rates are large, so you can do many measurements at a single shot. Whereas maybe in the ion trap simulation, it's a digital simulation with much smaller numbers of N, and the repetition rate is rather slow compared to our systems, meaning that doing stuff like quantum process tomography is quite prohibitively large, difficult. So to compare the system that we are looking at, which is superconducting circuits, I'll tell you a little bit more about it later. But in essence, we are looking at qutrits, or three-level systems, encoded in this intrinsically continuous variable or bosonic mode and harmonic oscillator. And if I were to say categorize our experiment, it is digital, it's also small n, and is fast, which allows us to take many measurements and probe all of Hilbert space. Just to flash a little bit towards maybe the future, there's this work from Norman Yao's group that looks at actually continuous variable scrambling in resonators. And that's also a kind of proposal that would be feasible to implement in our kind of system, though very, very different. So I also want to briefly just flash a slide on something that I'm not going to talk about too much, but just as an idea of what these kind of systems could potentially be capable of. These superconducting circuits, they're relatively easy to engineer in terms of how the layout is and how they look. So whether it's in 3D here, is this work in Chicago, you have these 3D pillar resonators, or in 2D planar, where you have these coplanar waveguide resonators, it's possible to align these kind of systems in lattices any way that you like. This case maybe is of particular interest, a recent paper where they aligned these in a hyperbolic lattice. In this case, there's no real interaction yet. But another feature that we have that's not combined in this case, but something that really is possible in these kind of systems, is to have very strong interactions. And as I'll show later, it's the Josephson junction that allows us to get really strong interactions between two photons in our case. So here you see the vacuum Rabi splitting, much larger than the line width in the results already in 2004. So I just wanted to flesh that out there as like an idea, as maybe something potentially as like an analog simulator that you could think of, where you could work with bosonic modes. For us, I will restrict ourselves to three-level systems. And there's also a quantum information argument to look at higher dimensional systems to encode quantum information, or qutrits. The one is that you get an increased computational power. It's obvious that your Hilbert space for the same number of elements is increased. but also the connectivity. If you think about local connected qubits versus qutrits or maybe qquarts or going further, you need fewer local gates to get similar connectivity, and we'll show this in the experiment later. And it's kind of like a hardware efficient way of making your system a little bit more efficient. One example here is this decomposition of a Toffoli gate, where if you do it with qubits, you scale linearly, and you can get logarithmic better scaling if you use qutrits to do this compilation. Another great example is these bosonic quantum error correction codes, where you really use the higher order photonic states in a bosonic unharmonic oscillator to do quantum error correction. And it turns out that in this case, a single harmonic oscillator is actually already enough to do some kind of cat code, as they call it. So that just as a broad overview. What I will show today is work on our superconducting circuit. I will explain the basics, and then also the work that we did to kind of transform this into a qutrit process or a ternary logic processor. Just to flesh it out here, we have these three states that we can read out of a single qutrit in this case. And then I'll show that we have two ways in which we study scrambling in this kind of system. First, because we can measure this really fast, we can actually do quantum process tomography on the two qutrit scrambler. And then secondly, we also measured scrambling probing out of time order correlators in this Hayden-Preskill kind of circuit, very similar to the work that you saw just probably from Chris Monroe's group. So far, any questions? Good. So these superconducting circuits are really engineered quantum systems. What they consist of is pieces of superconducting material. In our case, we use planar devices, aluminum or niobium, where we make low-loss electrical circuits because we cool them down to a few millikelvin where they go superconducting. We can align just by photolithography processes all these elements. So this is just a resonator or a cavity, if you will, with just this harmonic oscillator. These are our artificial atoms, as we like to call them. Right in the middle here, there's this Josephson junction, which gives the nonlinearity, which allows us to address each transition individually. And then we have these resonators that we can just define here, which give us interaction between them. And in this case here, we can read all of these resonators out to a single line to read out all of our qubit states or atoms individually. And in our case, the repetition rate of these experiments to get the single shot outcome is about 100 kilohertz, which really means that it's relatively easy for us to build up statistics. So the way that it works, I showed a coplanar waveguide version in the lumped element. You can description, you can write it like this. It's really just an LC resonator, which gives you resonance condition. If you cool it down, it can cool to the ground state. Apologize for also my graphics not coming completely through with this projector. But the point is that in this case, you get just an harmonic oscillator with equally spaced energy levels at millikelvin temperatures, which is naturally relaxed to the ground state. And then with microwaves, you can address the transition. But here it's still rather classical. And a nonlinear circuit, inductor, Josephson junction, you get a nonlinear relation here, and this makes this resonator anharmonic. So the energy needed to go from 0 to 1 is larger than from 1 to 2. And this means that you can encode, if you want, maybe a two-level qubit here in these lowest two ground states, or a qutrit in the lowest three in the game. So we connect the two capacitively, and this is the Hamiltonian that describes it. In the case where the resonator is very far detuned from the anharmonic resonator or the qubit, I will kind of use interchangeably qutrit or transmon for this, maybe sometimes atom. We have creation and annihilation operators for the cavity. If you restrict yourself only to the ground state here, you can describe the qubit just by the spin operator. So you just assume that you're never going to address these states. And then you have a coupling term, which is the readout, which is just a dispersive shift of the resonator. So it just tells you that the resonator frequency will shift by chi, which is the few megahertz, depending on the state of the qubit here. And then applying microwave fields, we can control the state of the of these two levels with sigma y and sigma x local operators. This is how it actually looks on the chip. So the cavity here, we don't have a lumped element implementation, but we just have just a resonator here called planar waveguide. So it's a lambda over 4 resonator. And the qubit, these are the capacitors, and they're shunted here in the middle by this Josephson junction, which is represented here. It's aluminum and aluminum oxide and aluminum, which is a tunnel junction that provides the nonlinearity. And we have a control line here that we go up to the outside world. This is just to repeat all the elements of the chip. Maybe I should pause here and ask if there's any questions on this part. So how do we read the system out? What we do is we actually reflect light or microwave tone at roughly 6 gigahertz off of the cavity. We have the transmission line here, and we send it into the circulator. Light comes into the cavity, it reflects back, and then depending on the qubit state, the light will acquire a phase shift that we then, the reflected light, we then amplify with the quantum limited amplifier. We mix it down with the readout tone. And then here at the end, we can look at the I and the Q quadrature of the reflected light. And now, in this case, the radio component here in this IQ, or you can think of it as P and Q of a harmonic oscillator, the radio component here gives you the phase of the reflected light. The length of the vector here gives you the number of photons. And so you can see that in this case, we either prepare the qubit in the zero state, or the one state, or the two state, and we get very nicely defined regions where we can identify the state of the qutrit. And just to note, every little dot here that you see is a single shot. And so by just dividing up the area here in these regions, we get in a single shot, we get a trit of information about our system. And we can do this with roughly, there's some imperfections. If we just do it between 0 and 1, we can get this to 99.9 or something. It's a little bit more tricky if you want to do it in this case, and you lose a few percent in the second state, but still fairly, fairly certain about this readout.
What sets the noise scale there? Is that, I mean, is that quantum fluctuations?
Here it is, okay. Almost. So if you're chained, you definitely see quantum fluctuations, but we also amplify classically here. So in the end, we do have classical noise, but as long as the separation is large enough compared to quantum noise, then the classical noise shouldn't matter anymore. And so if this is perfect, if this is unit efficiency, which in our case it's not, I think we reach about 50% quantum efficiency in these kind of devices. So then you add a little bit more than just the quantum noise. And then, so that's about the pure amplification and noise part of the measurement. There's also a more mundane thing that can go wrong, which is just T1 decay of the qubit during readout. And that also kind of broadens these peaks in not really a trivial way, because it would mean that you initially maybe started out in the two stage, you got some phase here, and then, you know, if the qubit decays to the one state, then it will kind of be smeared out in this direction. So it will not be your nice Gaussian noise, but it will have some pattern. But that's limiting the readout fidelity in our case. The fact that the qubit doesn't stay in the state that we're reading out during the time of the readout. Although it's only a few percent, but it isn't. So to show that we can do spectroscopy, what we can do is we can irradiate the qubit through the control line with a varying frequency field. We see these resonance conditions pop up if we look at the excitation probability, and we see these distinct resonances that correspond to exciting from 0 to 1 state, in this case the 1 to 2 state, and here I also plotted the 2 to 3 state just to show that we can address all of these on a bandwidth of a few hundred megahertz. The nice thing about these kind of systems is that to generate these frequencies, pulses, it's commercially available equipment, actually. It happens at the wavelength of Wi-Fi, so there's a lot of development there, and you can just buy a generator that makes these kind of tones. So then how do we think about a single qutrit? Just as a brief reminder, if you used to think about a spin 1/2 system, for a spin 1 system or a 3-level system, the generators of rotation are given by these Gell-Mann matrices, where if you just isolate, for instance, in lambda number 4, if you isolate here, you can see your familiar Pauli sigma x, y, and z, but then you also have, of course, the second level here. In our case, because we typically address the 0 to 1 transition and the 1 to 2 transition, these four Gell-Mann matrices come very natural to us because they are just microwave pulses at different frequencies. And so we think of them as just having a qubit in 0-1 space and 1-2 space, and then we can do these four. These two are diagonal, and for that reason, by playing with the phases with these two microwave pulses, we can also implement those. And then here you have operators that correspond to going from 0 to 2, which is suppressed. It has in principle, there shouldn't be a matrix element there. We could actually drive that transition. We sometimes do it, but in principle, by just doing these two in sequence, we can effectively generate these rotations, and it gives us arbitrary control over the effective spin one system. And so here, what we show is that if we turn on microwave pulses in actually both the 0-1 and the 1-2 transition at the same time, I plot the probability to be in 0, in 1, and in 2, and I chose the rates nicely such that you get some coherent oscillation between all of these three levels. And the time scale of manipulation is in the order of tens of nanoseconds. And the key takeaway is that initially, like back in the days when the systems were first investigated, lifetimes were maybe not so long. The phase coherence of this transition was already not so long. And because you have bosonic enhancement, the matrix element coupling this higher level state scales with square root n, and therefore you expect this to couple more to the environment, the phase more strongly. But because we make these systems better and better, material qualities improve, and controls improve, we're actually able to maintain coherence here over a fairly long time. And so, although decoherence comes into play, it's not a huge limitation in our case. At least it's not prohibitively large that we cannot address these at all. And so then in terms of logic gates, you can define your qutrit Pauli operators given by I, X, and Z. And then because X and Z, they cube to the identity as opposed to square to the identity, this is your Pauli group for thinking about logical gates on this kind of qutrit system. So we recently implemented, we did this after doing the work that I'm going to show later, but the typical way that people in quantum information like to define their control is by doing this this operation called randomized benchmarking. It's actually also the theory of random circuits, just applied to the question, how well can you actually drive your system? So what you do is you define a set of Paulis that you pick randomly, and you just apply them with variable depth. And then at the end, you do one of the single Pauli operation that makes sure that the whole thing here is identity. And so you try to do identity with a random set of chosen circuits, and then as a function of the depth, you look how well you do the identity, and you get this exponential decay. And in this case, we get like an error of 0.2% or something, which actually, if you calculate, this is qutrit Clifford gates. So that means that it's actually quite a few microwave gates per Clifford. It's on average about 3.5 microwave pulses that we send. And if you translate that to typical qubit fidelities that people have, it's actually very similar. So it's an error in the order of 10 to the minus 4.
So those are quiprots, right?
Yes.
They're not Paulis in this case.
Sorry, yes, are different. Yeah, so I didn't. We have the generators, and with that, we can stop our microwave pulses at any time that we want, and so we can generate pi over 2 rotations as well. I gave the Paulis because later it's going to be intuitive to think about the Paulis, but we have full control. And the way that we do it is actually we have Clifford gates, and then to get arbitrary control, we have these Z gates, where we can have just the phase precision of our microwave pulse, which we control with very large precision. So usually what we do is we have Clifford gates, and then we add like an arbitrary phase gate, which we have with very large precision. Yeah. Now the story usually becomes a little bit more challenging if you actually look at multiple qubits at the same time, or qutrits. So this is the same data where instead of doing this operation, randomized benchmarking, just on a single qutrit, we actually do it on two at the same time. So I here chose the same qutrit and then found these two neighbors. And when I start doing gates on both of them together, you see that the fidelity quite severely drops. It really depends on the details. In this case, it's actually almost an order of magnitude worse, the pulses. And while this is very common in quantum systems, in our case, there was one thing that we really needed to realize, which was that we needed to deal with microwave crosstalk. So if we look at the chip that we have, on this chip here, all of these lines are nicely microwave defined. And the field, if we just do simulation of the chip, it should be very local that's generated here. But actually, the way that you mount this to the outside world, you have wire bonds here, it comes in a box. This box can have different modes. And well, actually, currently, we do understand, and we have a full simulation of the whole system, and we understand where this crosstalk comes from. at the time we had our chip and we just saw that there was this crosstalk. And what we decided to do, what we saw, for instance, is if we drive one of the qubits or qutrits here, then we would also have some field at the location of qubit one. And while they're off-resonant, it might still cause some off-resonant oscillations. And that's why you see here, if you start to do simultaneous pulses, just the pulse fidelity is degraded. But the nice thing is that, in principle, you can characterize this crosstalk very well. So what we ended up doing is we constructed the matrix, and instead of thinking about gates, we just thought about there's a field that's generated by this line, and instead of it just being local and having no support here, this field that we drive on the control line, which is intended for qubit zero, just generates a field at the same frequency as all these locations. And since there's a qubit there, we can measure this field, and then what we can do is we can measure the actual field, which so we measure an actual field versus an implied field for all these lines. So this is a big matrix that has all these locations here and all these drive inputs, all these knobs. And then we can invert this matrix and just basically use destructive interference if you want to drive this qubit, to use all of these knobs to destructively interfere the field with all of these locations. And then that way you can significantly suppress the crosstalk this way. I want to note that this is not a scalable solution, so in the end we are going back to actually looking at the box and making it better such that there's lower crosstalk. That's already in the works. But there's always going to be some amount of crosstalk, and this method turns out to work really well. So just very briefly want to show the data here. The green is if we don't do anything, and in this case the orange is when we do have the crosstalk nothing applied. So this is now a matrix where if we drive qubit 0 and then also drive simultaneously qubit 1 or qubit 5 or qubit 6, you see that the orange is usually better than all of the others. This is just the error rate that we get if we don't do any crosstalk nulling and if we do crosstalk nulling. So that definitely helped in our operation and made it possible to do these experiments for us.
Why doesn't it improve for like Q7? Or is this already good?
What I didn't tell you is that we actually measured this. So I measured this matrix just after having one of our power outages, after one of the fires. And so what we think is that because actually this matrix calculating the actual field versus applied field, the function of location, there's dispersion in there. And after cycling, all of our qubits shifted a little bit. So what I think is that what's happened is that we're just in a slightly different regime here, and we'd have to redo the crosstalk nulling a little bit to tweak for that. There's also some subtleties where some actually couple more strongly. So I think nearest neighbors always couple strongly, and then some of them are also close in resonance. And so in this case, for instance, 0 and 6 are close in resonance, and therefore it's kind of counterintuitive, but because they're close in resonance, the signal of the crosstalk is very strong, therefore we can do a very good job nulling it. So for that reason, this one actually is doing really well, whereas for instance here, I think it's kind of both. There was this change, but then also maybe it doesn't couple as strong. So now having talked about single qubit control, let me talk a little bit about how we untangle these systems, what kind of interaction we have. This is also microwave driven, and it uses a cross-resonance effect. So we have these two qubits, and in the uncoupled case, this is the level diagram, so we have the control qubit here, if the control qubit is in 0 or in 1, and on this axis we have the target qutrit, whether it's in 0 or in 1. Just to set it up a little bit, suppose that we have this crosstalk nulled version where we can apply a local drive to this qubit in this case, applying it here, it would drive transitions in this direction. If we would apply it locally here, it would drive transitions here like this, so this is just local gates. But now if we would apply a field at the location of the control qubit, at the frequency of the target qubit, it actually kind of tries to drive these transitions, so it tries to drive 0, 0 to 1, 0, and 0, 1 to 1, 1. But because there's no spatial overlap between these two systems, these are just forbidden transitions, and so nothing would happen. Now if you turn on coupling, actually these levels hybridize a little bit, and therefore this transition actually becomes allowed. And because the hybridization tells you, or perturbation theory tells you that hybridization comes in with opposite signs, the sign with which you drive this transition is also opposite sign. So what this tells you is that by applying this kind of gate where you drive the control qubit at the frequency of the target qubit, what you're going to do is you're, depending on the target, depending on the control qubit state, you're either going to drive with plus omega or with minus omega. So you're going to have clockwise or anti-clockwise rotations, and that's what gives you an effective ZX interaction. So I explained this for qubits. It actually also generalizes for qutrit. You have to play a few tricks. I don't want to go too much into details here, but what I show you is that if we apply this gate, and we prepare the control qutrit in either the 0, the 1, or the 2 state, you start to get these oscillations where we really nicely tuned it here such that only if the control was in 1, the target qutrit in the 0 and 1 subspace oscillates a little slower. And so you see that depending on the z state of the control, the x of the target changes. And this allows us to implement this unitary that's, if we stop the gate at this time, a unitary gate that flips, exactly puts a pipe pulse on the 0 to 1 target control, depending on the target state, depending on the control state. And if the control would have been in 0 or in 2, we would have gotten identity. Typically, we can do this in about between 100 and 200 nanoseconds, and then we do this for all local pairs. So we do this between nearest neighbors to tune up gates. Now with this gate, we can look at trying to generate a canonical entangled state between these two qutrits. So this is the circuit that we use. We have some local gates here, and then with two of these conditional pi gates that we have here, we can in the end generate this EPR state, entangled state between two qutrits, and 0, 1, 1, 2, 2. It's fairly high fidelities that require two of these gates. So roughly, in this case, we have like a 99% fidelity gate rough estimation. Now in the current device, which I will show data on, we actually had 5 qutrits working, which turns nicely out that for this Hayden-Preskill implementation, that was exactly the number that we needed. I want to point out some of the limitations here as well. And in our case, one of the crucial things is that this gate depends strongly on the detuning between a pair of qubits. So if you, for that reason, we actually try to fabricate these qubits at very precise frequencies, but sometimes this fabrication process goes wrong. Qubits may be farther off resonance, and you see that if the detuning is maybe more than 300 megahertz, you really cannot do a good interaction between them, and therefore we discard them. And that's what happens in this case. That's why we say, even though we fabricated 8, we only have 5 qubits working here. And so, ever since, we've done a lot of work on trying to optimize the uniformity in qubit parameters. So what we did, actually, what you see here is a wafer that has, it's kind of hard to see, but it actually has 64 8-qubit chips on an automated probe station. Luckily, in this case, the qubit frequency, even though it varies, we can predict very well at room temperature what it's going to be, because it's just measuring the critical current of the Josephson junction, and it's very indicative of the frequency that we're going to find later. So we can measure, we can make many of these, and then we can do feedback loops without having to cool down all of these devices, just by probing the critical current of the junctions. And then the takeaway here, what you see is that by doing all these kind of fabrication improvements, looking at how the layers, the tunneling junction layers formed during oxidation, working very well with the resist stack that we made to make the junction here, we managed to get from a wafer here, so this is plotting the variance of all the qubit measured critical currents, where we get a variance of maybe 20 or 30%, we get it down by about an order of magnitude. I think the qubit's much more uniform, and therefore much more likely to be on target. And that, in our case, increases the yield of having 8 qubits that are feasible to do gates between from about 0.5% to about 5%. So if we make 60 in one run, then we have a good chance that we have a good chip. Actually, this is what we did a few weeks ago, so I just wanted to flash the data here. And this is a spread of frequencies for qubit 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, so 8 qubits. And then later we reduce that spread a lot and makes our yield much better. Now looking at the scrambling, unless there's any questions about the more technical part there. So the kind of scrambling unitary that we implemented, as I said, we're not looking at the time dynamics of the scrambling operation. We're really asking the question, after applying a certain unitary U, has the system scrambled and how much has it scrambled? And the definition that we actually got from Ben Yoshida and Norman Yao is by saying that if every single qutrit Pauli operator is mapped to a two-body operator, this is when scrambling has maximally happened. It kind of gives you the idea that information starts local, is completely spread out over all degrees of freedom. So That means for, if you look at evolution under a certain unitary U, which is labeled PG as the Pauli group on either, in this case, a two-body system, either on the left part or on the right part, if it evolves under a unitary that is scrambling, then a local operator here gets met to some other non-local operator that has support on both sides. So just to give an example, this is the unitary that we're going to implement. It's actually just a permutation of eigenstates, so it maps I and j to 2i plus j and I plus j, such that, for instance, local z here maps to z squared, local z here maps to z squared, such that there's never an identity here. So it's always mapping local to non-local information. It turns out that according to this definition, the smallest system that you can study this in is two qutrits. And if you would want to study this in, for instance, qubits, you need more of them. That's also why in the other experiments, they need three qubits to look at the scrambling. So this is how this permutation looks. You see that every eigenstate, kind of under evolution of this scrambler, gets mapped to another eigenstate. We can actually decompose this unitary into a conditional sum gate, which we just defined as adding the state of one together. So it's just ij goes to I plus j, where in this case this is the control and this is the target. And if we apply two of those C sums in sequence, that actually gives us the scrambler here. So now the nice thing about our system is that we can actually test whether we do this unitary properly. I've showed you how we do the single qutrit, two qutrit gates, and we can do this reconstruction. And the way that we're going to test it first is by doing process tomography. And I think this really nicely visualizes the concept of scrambling. So what we're going to plot is the Pauli transfer matrix, which really looks at how a certain operator, which is here on this axis, evolves under a unitary U. And the way that I order these is, usually this is, it's a two, we're looking at two body operators here, so it's a 81 by 81 system. And you can think of this as input states or input density matrices, as you will. And then you can, on this axis, you can read out after this density matrix has evolved under U, how is it decomposed into all of the other bodies. And so I order them such that all of the local operators on the first qubit qutrit input are here, and the second one they're here. And you see, just to give an example, if you would have done a local gate, if U is a local gate here, then local operators stay here in this local space. Now this was this is the theory for if you would have done one of these C-sum gates, where you see that it actually starts to generate some entanglement. So some of the local operators here get mapped to a two-body operator, but there's also some operators that stay local. Whereas if you have a scrambler, this is all theory, by the way, all local operators here get mapped onto a non-local two-body operator. And so in that sense, the absence of any local local correlators here after doing this unitary shows you that you've maximally scrambled. So that's the theory. The experiment here, if we do a local gate and then an entangling gate using this cross-resonance scale that I showed you, and a scrambling gate, really seeing that we can map out this behavior and really see after this unitary where all of these correlators go. We can do this with very high precision. Now, if you would have done full process tomography, it actually would have been, you also would have looked at all the two-body operators as input that characterizes the full process. I didn't show you because it's not maybe too intuitive, but just to actually show that we can do this measurement, it's really a lot of tomography measurements. And it takes us 1.5 hours, which is relatively impressive given that our repetition rate, it's 3 kilohertz. Like, this is going to be hard to do on systems that maybe have a hertz of repetition rate that would take you forever. But still, it doesn't scale. If I now ask the question, how do I do this on a 3-qutrit system, it would just take relatively long. So we know that this method, even though it's nice to debug everything, and for me, also pedagogically, to show what's happening in your system, we really also like the tools to find out that your system is scrambling without having to do process tomography. And for that, we look at the teleportation circuit, or the circuit in the Hayden-Preskill setting that we've already heard about. So it turns out that by this paper by Benny and Norm, there's also a 5-qutrit version of the same circuit that we saw earlier. So you can think about it in the Hayden-Preskill setting, where if you want to think of the dynamics of the scrambling dynamics as being a black hole, you can think of it as a black hole and its complement that are entangled with each other. And then there's a quantum information protocol where basically Alice throws in a qutrit in this end of the black hole. And then by measuring outputs of the unitary here, or measuring Hawking photons, probabilistically the state can get teleported from one black hole here to a reference state. And that's the circuit that we implement, where the key thing is that this unitary has to be scrambling for this to this protocol to work. And so, as was mentioned earlier, is by measuring here the probability of success and looking at the fidelity of the teleportation state, you can also distinguish decoherence from through scrambling in this case. So I just wanted to flesh out one of the examples of how qutrits can actually give you an effect of higher connectivity, because if you compare, we have a linear locally connected chain of only 5 qutrits, that kind of gets away with not having to do an all-to-all connectivity, even though we would obviously would love to have all-to-all connectivity. But in a way, using this richness of this higher Hilbert space, we can kind of get around that, and we only need local gates here to do like a similar similar depth scrambling operation. Now, implementing the circuit, there are some technical problems that we run into. It turns out that if we operate our circuits in parallel, we see that in isolation we can prepare these nice EPR pairs. If we do it simultaneously, our fidelity significantly drops. And it turns out that there's some spurious interactions between all of our qutrits that are always on, because this coupling resonator is always there. We don't have tunable coupling in that sense. And so what this means is that if we start to do these operations simultaneously, the state, for instance, of qubit 2 is going to depend on the state of qubit 3. And if you want to do isolated operations here, that's a bad thing. So we actually verify this by looking at the state of this when we prepare this in simultaneously of one pair, and then we look actually post-select on the state of qutrit 3, and we see that if we post-select on it, the state is rather pure. But if we add all of these, they have different phases here, and that's why we have kind of a defacing. So it's not really defacing; it's just entanglement where we don't want it. I'm actually going to skip ahead here and just give you the solution, because it turns out that you can do dynamical decoupling protocols. So you might be familiar here with spin 1, where you have an echo, you just apply a pipe pulse in the middle, and while this also decouples you from defacing, it can also decouple you from neighboring qubits. For qutrits, this works very similarly, except you have to apply 3 Pauli operators here, separate them by the same time, and that allows you to in this case, decouple, for instance, qutrit 3 from qutrit 1 and 2 while we generate entanglement there. And that way, if we do simultaneously dynamical decoupled protocol, we can get these with still relatively high fidelity. And so we implemented all of these dynamical decoupling schemes throughout the algorithm, also during scrambling. And that was really a key thing to make this experiment work. So now looking at the teleportation, this is the whole decomposition of how we do the protocol. Just here, the EPR pair generation simultaneously. I didn't put the dynamical decoupling pulses in there. They are there in principle. I just wanted to flesh this out to show roughly the depth of the circuit. There's about 14 two qutrit gates here that we have, and the depth is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. What we do is we prepare different input states here on Q1. And we measure on this pair, and conditioned on the measurement, we look at the output state and compare it to the input state to see if we properly teleport it. We do this for 12 input qutrit states, which form a 2 design. And what I show here is decomposed in the Gell-Mann matrices for all 12 input states, the ideal dashed and the measured correlators of the density matrix of the target state. So, roughly to check, you can see that where we want the correlations, they are there. It's not very quantitative, but this is just to show that we do this for all the 12 states. And roughly by eye, you can see that the measured state, which is the light blue here, matches the correlations that we're looking for.
So why the inputs should make?
So the point is that you want to characterize your process in a fair way. So you kind of want to sample the whole space. It could be that your circuit is kind of biased towards certain states. I can give you one example, which is relatively easy to understand.
Yeah, well, sorry, question. This is not the scrambling to design. This is some some other condition that you put on the initial system.
Yes, it's just a condition on under which conditions, which input states are we going to use to test if the teleportation protocol is working.
Oh, yeah, so that makes sense if you want to do some markup here.
Yeah, so just to fairly sample the operation in a sense, and the thing is that to fairly sample the whole Hilbert space, you want your input states to form a 2D zone. Which for a qutrit you need these 12 states. So looking at it a little bit more quantitatively, here we plot the fidelity of the measured state with the ideal state for these 12 states that form a 2D sign. I put two bounds on here because if you compare to a thermal state, which in the Hayden-Preskill protocol would be similar to saying you just do a random guess, right? Suppose that you have somebody wants to check that Bob actually teleported the state, and best you could do is just doing a random guess, then you would find 1/3 here, so that's one limit. Typically in teleportation, you also compare to another situation where it's kind of like cheating, like Alice didn't actually throw the state into the black hole, she just gave it to Bob, and all he can do is measure it, and then send the measurement result, use that to try to show that he teleported it. In that case, he doesn't know in which basis the state was prepared, so he doesn't always measure in the right basis. And in that case, the limit for showing if you do teleportation or not would be 50%. In qubit cases would have been 66%, so that's a common metric for seeing if you do classical or quantum teleportation.
How do you measure whether it's fully scrambled or not?
So this is a parameter we tune. Thanks for asking that. It turns out that our decomposition of the scrambler, there is a continuous way, and it's actually only by changing these Hadamard gates. And actually without much complexity, loss of complexity, it's just one phase gate, which is something that we can do with high accuracy. We can, with the same complexity, make this scrambler continuously tune from something that effectively does identity to something that's a full scrambling operation. And so it's not something that we measure, it's something that I just put in. So when I tune our decomposition to be identity, but while maintaining the complexity, we find that we get very close to a thermal state. And then if we tune this parameter such that our unitary should be maximally scrambling in theory, we find an average of 56, which is way above this 50% limit. Does that make sense? Yeah. All right, so that's actually the final data that I wanted to show. We're wrapping this up currently, writing up the results just in the almost non-remaining time. I just wanted to flesh up a short summary of what we did. Showed you that we have this 5 qutrit processor. In this case, we showed that we can control qutrits fairly well, implement the scrambling unitary, verify it by quantum process tomography, as well as this teleportation protocol in the Hayden-Preskill setting. And then, just to flash a brief outlook, one of the things we're looking into now is, since we have this qutrit control, there's also a nice connection to quantum error correction. There are these holographic error correction codes that are, from a quantum information perspective, robust against qutrit erasure that we could now implement. They also have a connection to the Ryu-Takanagi formula, and we could start to think about measuring entanglement entropies, and then continue using these qubits to measure connections with quantum information and energy physics. And with that, let me just flash the team. Thank in particular Vinay Ramesh, PhD student who's now at Google AI, and the rest of the team, as well as what we're doing. Thank you for your attention.